So good afternoon to everybody. Thank you very much, Leticia, for your introduction. So please bear with me for this last presentation. The day is almost over. I think the presentation before make a good point regarding the interest behind induction heating. There are many of you that are today using this process or are interested in using it for several reasons. And at Transvalor, we have here your demand. You're really expecting to have not only good quality for the simulation in order to compare with the experimental results that, as it was shown, we are getting really good results, but also there are expectations regarding the computational time. So today, I would like to introduce several features and improvements we have done in order to render the program, the software, more flexible and reliable for you. So first, I would like to introduce some several features. Before going into subject, please take into account I have put on the top of each slide the version on which each feature or improvement will be present. So the first point, it's regarding material characterization. So already you have within the Forge and classically in the thermomechanical computations a large library of material descriptions. And as it has been said several times, we have a really strong partnership with Center Software and GMAT Pro. So we also work in order to have the electromagnetic material characterization available for you so that when you define your material from GMAT Pro, you can also rely on the electromagnetic behavior that is given from the software. So now this is transparent and it can be used as an input for the simulation of the process. Another request that was done for the users of the 2.1 version was the possibility to pilot the electric input as a function of the process time. And so what we need to keep in mind is that from the simulation point of view, we're dealing with two time scales. For the electromagnetic aspect, we need to deal with the electric signal described by a sinus function. And from the process time, that is usually longer than the one for the electric signal. So in order to achieve this request, we introduce the possibility of piloting the amplitude or the root mean square value of the electric signal, as well as frequency and even the phase of the signal as a function of the process time coming from the thermomechanical solver. So we also introduce in this version for the 3.0 the possibility of defining multiple inductors. Each one can have an independent, not only the signal, but also kinematics. This case, you can find it in the Transvalor web analysis under crankshaft, if you're interested. Keep in mind, for these kind of configurations, we still need to work for complex electric piloting. But if it is a simple sinusoidal piloting, then there is no problem. And maybe we'll talk after the presentation regarding the multi-frequency to give some details regarding that. For those of you that are that know about the simulation of induction problem, so you know that sometimes a hypothesis that is done is to input a current density on the inductor or to force it, and then just focus on the induction problem within the billet, okay? But what is important to know is that actually it is important to take into account the coupling between the inductor and the billet, because the presence, the inductor itself, it's going to have a distribution of the electric current, and this distribution and also the one in the billet will affect the results. This was put into evidence after a campaign done in collaboration with the NTN SNR, in which we show that taking into account the self-induction in the inductor that is piloting the process will completely modify the heat-affected zone and also the expectation of the and the results of the austenite profile at the end of the process, as you can see on the right-hand side. So there's a concentration of the austenite profile that is closer to the experiment. And if we didn't, in the case we didn't take the self-induction, actually the heat-affected zone was going upwards around this dumbbell part. So this shows the importance of taking the full physical phenomena into account. So for the moment, the only detail is that, of course, taking this into account, increase the CPU time, but we're working into improving this aspect. Continuing into the taking into account the whole physical phenomena, so we have also included, this is going to be for the 4.0 version, the possibility of using all the Lorentz forces also in induction heating problem if you are interested in doing so, maybe because distortion is a problem, maybe because you also want to do computation on the inductor, at the inductor level, that it can be problematic. For instance, in certain cases, it can the inductor can have a thermomechanical fatigue. So if that's the case, then you have the possibility of doing the full thermomechanical computation on both the billet and the inductor. Something else, we have worked into refactoring and modifying the outputs from the electromagnetic solver in order to simplify the use of all the results we get. And one that is can be really interesting is to electrically characterize the system. Because sometimes if we want to do some fast computation, or calculation of the energy consumption, it is a good approach to have the electrical representation of the system. So from the typical outputs that you already have from the simulation, you know, the VTA files that have a global results, you will find the DC electric resistance of the inductor, and then as you can see from the scheme, a representation or a simplification of as equivalent resistance and inductance of the whole system seen from the inductor point of view. So now we'll present several solver improvements that has been introduced into the software. In order to show you where we have worked, I will use at each moment this diagram to tell you at which points we have intervened. So the first aspect regarding the piloting of the thermal evolution, there's an option that you already had with the 2.1 version, was the possibility of controlling the temperature using a PID control. But the problem is that in the last version, this control was done with a fixed point in space. So it means that if there were any deformations due to thermal expansion or movement, it was not possible to correctly do the controlling. So now we have modified the concept in order to imagine or to do an actual projection as if we had a laser within the simulation, and then this control point is simply calculated as a projection on the billet, and then the piloting and the control of the temperature and actually the modification of the electric signal is done as always. Next, there's a new coupling condition that has been introduced in order to improve the CPU time for some specific kind of cases. So this option, it's called stationary fields, And it was mainly thought for cases with rotational kinematics and also rotational symmetries. And in these kind of cases, so we can imagine that if the distortion is not big, we can reuse somehow the electromagnetic field that was computed from before. So the idea here is to, so before we were obliged to couple not only using a temperature criteria, but also to couple every x degrees of rotation. And this meant that we also had to do an electromagnetic computation every time. And now with this approach, the idea is that basically once we have done a first electromagnetic computation, we'll use it as long as the temperature criteria has not been reached. And with this technique, for this kind of cases, we can achieve really high speed ups. And depending on the case, it can be just a few percentage, but sometimes can go up to 6, 10 times, or it can be even more. Then we'll show a couple of developments done at the core of the electromagnetic problem. The first one, it's related to the discretization of the partial differential equation behind, so basically the Maxwell equation, and the information we send to the thermomechanical solver. Basically, we have changed the the way we discretize in time in order to compute the time integral of the periodic problem, going from an implicit one-time step discretization. Many of you know from a numerical analysis, the classical Euler implicit approach, to a two-time steps approach called Dupont implicit. This is actually the same that is used in the for the thermal problem in FORGE. And this scheme is quite stable and robust. And also, we change the way we integrate in time the post-processed fields. For instance, here I show the Joule heat term that is given, that is computed from the as a mean of the an electromagnetic period. And this is information we send to the thermal solver. From this simple case, what I show here is that by changing these two time discretization problems, we can converge faster. And when I say converge faster, it means that for the same number of time steps for each period, we are closer to the expected, for instance, in this case, analytical result. We're already quite close to the to the result we need, and we don't have to do so many time how to say to discretize with small time steps in order to achieve a good result as compared with the previous method. The second approach, and this for the moment it's integrated but not commercially available, I will say, it's regarding the space discretization. And we have introduced what is known as perfectly matched layers. This approach basically simulates infinity and is used to absorb waves that are leaving the domain of computation. And the idea is that we knew since the beginning that using this air box that we put around our electromagnetic problem actually affects to a certain degree the computation of the heat the Joule heat term. And so we wanted to have an approach that enabled us to render the simulation let's say independent of this air box size that is put around the problem. So from these developments that we have integrated, we managed to obtain some really good results and render the simulation almost independent of this airbox around. There are some still some couple of developments we need to do in order to render transparent for you. Another key aspect that we found that is blocking and one of the main bottlenecks for CPU time improvements is actually the communication between the solvers. So we have worked a lot into improving these points. What I show here is that, so from the electromagnetic point of view, we have a single mesh. And so we need to accelerate or optimize the domain we use to send information. And here what I show is that by intelligently filtering our electromagnetic domain, and for instance, in this case, filtering all the air around, we can improve the transport problem time by a factor of 4 in this case. Then when we recover the temperature in the electromagnetic problem, here in this case, there's no change because actually the source problem is still the compact, let's say, and the same. And then if we have, for instance, a remeshing in the electromagnetic problem, then we also gain a lot of time by avoiding transport on the air. And well, something additional, these are actually all results. I have included another optimizations by filtering any part that is not thermomechanically activated. And in that case, we gain from these results a factor of around 10. So for the last point, when I was working on my PhD thesis before joining Transvalor in electromagnetic pulse forming, I included an adaptation technique that allows to use the same air mesh, so not regenerate the mesh, and just displace it. And this can help to gain a lot of computational time. So now we have moved or rendered this option available also for induction heating, and it can help when you have just small distortions to save a lot of computational time. In this example, what we show is that if we compare doing a simple adaptation, this just a small step, it takes 1 second. If we have to do a remesh plus the transport problem, it's almost 1 minute. So you can imagine if you extrapolate during the whole process or even if you have a bigger problem. So in order to finish this talk, I have shown you an exhaustive list of new features and improvements we have introduced into the software, some that you have already available in the NXT 3.0, like extending the material library, the possibility of multi-inductors, taking into account the whole coupling of the physical problem with self-induction, and so on, the piloting for PID control. Then there are some new features for the 4.0. And in the future, so there's still one blocking point, is when we do the remeshing, we know that we can still improve how we manage the electromagnetic mesh. We can gain a lot of CPU time there. So to render also available the perfectly matched layer approach, transparent for the user. And I'm personally looking for also for partners that are willing to work on electromagnetic pulse forming, because this is already also available in the 3.0. So thank you very much. And if you have questions, I will be happy to answer.